Throughout the Vietnam War, a silent battle raged in the shadows, a battle that would ultimately affect the outcome of battles on the ground and perhaps the outcome of the war itself. Monitoring the enemy's plans, tracking his movements, deceiving and manipulating him, and disrupting his communications. These were tactics employed on the deadly electronic battlefield. On one side of this battlefield stood the men of the United States Army Security Agency, the Air Force Security Service, the Naval Security Group, the Royal Australian Signal Corps, and South Vietnam's Special Security Technical Branch. On the other side of the battlefield stood highly disciplined teams of communist signal intercept operators called Technical Reconnaissance Agents. Handpicked for their loyalty and intelligence, the men of both sides operated with deadly proficiency, continuously perfecting the art of electronic warfare. The main weapons deployed on that battlefield included signal detection, interception, and location systems, cryptographic equipment, and code-breaking devices. The troops they deployed included equipment operators, cryptanalysts, linguists, electronics technicians, communications specialists, pilots, mechanics, cooks, and clerks. By the very nature of their work, these men and their deeds went without recognition except by those who had the need to know. 30 years have passed since their war ended. Still, much of their history remains hidden beneath a blanket of secrecy. Their story begs to be told, and we hope to shed a little light on them. Foremost among them was, perhaps, an elite group of electronic warriors within the United States Army Security Agency, officially designated the 1st ASA Company. Like other ASA units in Vietnam, it operated under a Radio Research cover designation. The men of the 1st Radio Research Company, however, adopted a more colorful nom de guerre, the Crazy Cats. The emblem that emblazoned their aircraft and uniforms was designed, it is said, by artists at MGM Studios, who saddled their cartoon cat Tom upon a flying Pegasus. Symbolizing the electronic nature of his flight, he held a lightning bolt lance in his paw. Perhaps that is what led the Crazy Cats to choose Cat's Paw as their radio call sign. Flying in Lockheed P-2 Neptune aircraft, borrowed from the U.S. Navy, the Crazy Cats flew missions to collect communications intelligence, referred to as COMINT. Most of these missions were flown over the infamous Ho Chi Minh Trail, an intricate network of roads, trails, and depots that brought North Vietnamese soldiers, equipment, and supplies through Laos and Cambodia into South Vietnam. Though the aging Neptunes were of Korean War vintage, the electronic eavesdropping and jamming systems inside were then state-of-the-art. Their mission signified a major leap forward in terms of scope and capability, a hallmark in the evolution of COMINT technology. The defeat of Germany in May 1945 and Japan in August brought joyous celebrations for the Allied forces and their civilian populations. It also brought swift changes at the War Department. On the 15th of September, it consolidated the Army's various cryptologic and intelligence components, creating the Army Security Agency. The ESA was given a charter to exercise command over all signal intelligence and communications security operations of the United States Army. Signal intelligence, or SIGINT, included radio direction finding, known as DF, and communications intelligence, known as COMINT. DF was employed to detect enemy signals and to locate their transmitters. COMINT, on the other hand, was employed to intercept enemy communications for decoding, translating, and analysis. Communication security, or COMSEC, included the development of encryption codes and devices for the U.S. Army, as well as monitoring its own communications for security violations. ASA's organizational structure had no parallel in the rest of the Army. Its unique vertical command structure and centralized control over the Army's SIGINT and COMSEC functions set it apart, as did the high security barriers that shielded the details of its operations. ASA was literally an army within an army, replicating in miniature all the functions of the larger army, ranging from personnel recruitment and training to research and development. The ASA established its headquarters at the historic Arlington Hall Station, Virginia, a former woman's junior college until World War II began, when it became the headquarters of ASA's predecessor, the Signal Security Agency. The ASA would direct a worldwide organization consisting of theater headquarters in Europe and the Far East, and a series of fixed sites or field stations that encircled the globe and served as its collection arm. The war had come to an end, and in October of that year, the United Nations was established, but the dream of a world at peace would be short-lived, as it soon split into two opposing camps. The Soviet Union, one of America's great wartime allies, began to pursue policies utterly opposed to American ideals and interests. War's end had left the countries of Eastern Europe occupied by the Soviets, who crushed the people's hopes for post-war democracy.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe: Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia.
Elsewhere, Soviet-controlled communist parties attempted to subvert free nations of Western Europe, the Americas, Africa, and Asia. Though the term was not coined until 1948, the Cold War had already begun. The onset of the Cold War substantially changed American military and intelligence priorities. As a result, in 1947, the National Security Act was signed into law by President Truman. On the intelligence side, the act established the National Security Council, which reported directly to the president. At the same time, the Office of Strategic Services was replaced by the establishment of the Central Intelligence Agency. On the military side, the War Department became the Department of the Army. Its Army Air Corps became the Air Force under the direction of a newly established Department of the Air Force. The existing Department of the Navy remained essentially intact, retaining command over the Marine Corps and Coast Guard. These three military branches now fell under the direction of the newly created National Military Establishment, which would soon evolve into the Department of Defense. The restructure resulted in a partial dismantling of the ASA. In 1948, the ASA's air-related functions were transferred to the newly activated Air Force Security Service, or AFSS. Meanwhile, the Navy's cryptologic and intelligence activities were consolidated under the Naval Security Group, or NSG. Like the ASA, many of their most important functions were transferred to a new joint service organization, the Armed Forces Security Agency, or AFSA, which would support and coordinate their cryptologic and intelligence activities. By 1952, AFSA's functions were absorbed by the newly established National Security Agency, or NSA. In addition, the NSA was granted SIGINT operational control over the Army Security Agency, the Naval Security Group, the Air Force Security Service, as well as the CIA. Adding to the fear and foreboding of the post-war period, the Soviets began a blockade of West Berlin in 1948, threatening a new war. Though the blockade was broken a year later by the Allies' Berlin airlift, there was soon worse to come. On the 23rd of September, 1949, the Soviet Union shocked the free world with the detonation of their first atomic bomb. Then, a week later, on the 1st of October, Communist Party Chairman Mao Zedong proclaimed the People's Republic of China as he raised its new flag above Beijing following the military defeat of President Chiang Kai-shek's nationalists, who were making a hasty retreat to the island of Formosa. To counter the red tide, the United States adopted a policy of containment to stem the tide by military force if necessary. The strength of American willpower was quickly put to the test. On the 25th of June, 1950, North Korea invaded the South, igniting the Korean War. The surprise attack caught the U.S. unprepared. While they were able to quickly send reinforcements from Japan, it would be months before the ASA would arrive. Although the ASA had listening posts around the world, they were fixed stations, and the surprise attack had left the ASA unprepared to provide tactical support on the battlefield. The buildup of U.S. troops in Korea, as well as Europe, led the ASA to create tactical support units on a large scale. Soon, groups and battalions became a fixture within the agency's force structure, and by 1956, the number of such units would grow from 0 to 9. Other ASA mission shifts included their assuming responsibility in 1955 for the Army's electronic intelligence, or ELINT, the interception of non-communication signals, as well as electronic warfare, or EW, the jamming or deception of enemy communications. However, the ASA's main focus would remain on COMINT. By 1960, on the eve of U.S. intervention in Vietnam, ASA was better prepared and better equipped than at any time to go to war. Although its primary focus remained on manning its worldwide chain of field stations, the agency possessed the necessary components for supporting combat troops, an R&D and material development capability geared to deploy new systems, and an efficient personnel system for recruiting, training, and sustaining a highly qualified force. The Crazy Cats were not the first, last, or only warriors on Vietnam's electronic battlefield. The first of them were there long before the first combat troops stepped upon Vietnamese soil. They'd also be among the last to leave.
Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and the success of liberty.
True to his word, President Kennedy responded to the growing communist insurgency in Vietnam. The ink had barely dried on America's friendship treaty with South Vietnam when on the 29th of April 1961, he directed the Army Security Agency to assist and train the South Vietnamese in radio direction finding, or simply DF. On the 11th of May, Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson arrived in Saigon to discuss increased aid with the South Vietnamese officials. 2 days later, on the 13th of May, the first contingent of 93 American electronic warriors arrived at Tan Son Nhut Air Force Base, joining some 750 other American military advisors already in country. This coincided with a declaration that same day by both President Kennedy and Secretary of State Dean Rusk that the Republic of Vietnam was to get added military and economic assistance, and that consideration was to be given to the use of U.S. forces if necessary to help resist internal communist pressure in Vietnam. Upon its arrival, the 400th ASA Company was given the cover designation 3rd Radio Research Unit, or 3rd RRU. This marked the first time that an entire Army unit had been deployed to Vietnam. Previously, only individual advisors had been assigned. They entered Vietnam under U.S. passports, and although they were authorized to carry weapons, they were to dress only in civilian clothing. Their military records read, "If killed or injured, report as accident in the Philippines." Under Operation White Birch, 78 of its men were assigned the task of targeting Viet Cong transmitters. Under Operation Sabretooth, another 15 men were to train South Vietnamese SIGINT specialists supporting the Army of the Republic of Vietnam, or ARVN. The 3rd RRU headquarters and processing elements immediately found a home in a warehouse near the Tan Son Nhut airstrip. Its personnel were initially billeted at Saigon's Majestic Hotel until more permanent quarters were found. Enlisted men eventually moved to a newly constructed building at 39 Hai Bachung Street, occupying 6 of its floors. Officers found quarters in nearby bungalows. On the 15th of May, the 3rd RRU was up and running. Inside vans located along the airstrip, White Birch operators were beginning to tune their radios in search of manual Morse signals. A month later, they moved to the nearby Vietnamese Joint General Staff compound, headquarters of South Vietnam's own signal intercept efforts. Sabretooth also opened a school at the compound in July and began training Arvin SIGINT soldiers. At the end of June, White Birch had established a net of 3 semi-permanent medium-range direction finding stations, or MRDF. These sites were at Ha Tien in the southwest, at Vung Tau on the eastern coast, and at Nha Trang on the central coast. These would simultaneously tune in on an enemy signal and take its bearings. The point where the 3 lines of bearings intersected would result in a fix. The net would then pass the general targeting location along to mobile short-range direction-finding teams, or SRDF teams, in the field. Operating from 5 to 15 miles from enemy transmitters, the SRDF teams used portable direction finders, the ANPRD-1, to refine the fixes. Once the enemy's position was sufficiently pinpointed, South Vietnam's armed forces could then engage the target. DF technology had been around since radios were first invented in the early 1900s and was used in World War I. DF had undergone many developments in the succeeding years, and by 1961, the ASA possessed the best equipment and operators in the world. Nevertheless, its White Birch team soon found that accurate bearings were hard to get due to Vietnam's geography, its unique signal propagation characteristics, and other factors. In addition, transport of SRDF teams to remote locations was both difficult and increasingly dangerous. This situation led the ASA to a search for solutions, including the possibility of an airborne radio direction finding system, referred to as ARDF or ARDF. To develop the ARDF concept, the ASA began a collaboration with the Army Electronics Command, or ECOM, laboratories at Fort Monmouth, New Jersey. Meanwhile, the 3rd RRU renewed its efforts to make DF successful, utilizing the resources they had at hand. Since SRDF teams often operated in close proximity to enemy operators, they risked the loss of men as well as highly classified electronic equipment. Evidence would later emerge that the enemy was fully aware of the mission of these DF teams and had taken steps to target them. For 25-year-old Tom Davis, the 22nd of December began like any other since his arrival in May. Early that morning, he left Tansinut in his 3-quarter-ton truck, leading 1 of 3 teams to monitor VC radio broadcasts in the field. With him was a team of 10 Arvin SIGINT soldiers and a portable radio direction finder, the ANPRD-1. With an Arvin driver at the wheel, perhaps his thoughts wandered toward his wife Gary, his 13-month-old daughter Cindy, and his mother and father back in Livingston, Tennessee, who were preparing for the Christmas holidays. When first assigned to Vietnam, the country was not yet front-page news, and he had to search it out on a map. Once in Vietnam, he wrote home expressing his fascination with the Vietnamese people and his belief that his efforts were helping secure a better future for them. Initially, Davis saw little enemy activity, but as the months passed, the Viet Cong attack steadily increased in frequency and proximity. Just recently, another RD team had been ambushed along the road. They were lucky, though, and had escaped unharmed. With that incident fresh in his mind, he must have been looking nervously along the brush-lined road leading back to Highway 10 and Saigon as they were returning from the field later that morning. At 11:40, 12 miles west of Saigon and less than a mile from a civil defense outpost at the village of Duc Hoa, his fears were realized. An explosion rocked the truck, ripping out the tailgate. A remote-controlled mine planted in the road had detonated. The truck limped along another 30 yards before it died at the right side of the road. As dazed and wounded Arvin soldiers scrambled from the disabled vehicle, some 20 VC opened fire, cutting them down, killing 9 of the 10. Davis, riding in the cab, grabbed his M14 rifle and jumped from the smoking truck and returned fire. He only had time to fire 4 or 5 shots before a VC bullet found its mark, killing him instantly. Specialist 4, James Thomas Davis, RA 14696877, made the ultimate sacrifice for his country and claimed his tragic place in history. Declared by the press and the president to be the first American killed in action in Vietnam, post-war accounts would place him fourth. Whether first or fourth, he would be far from the last. Several days earlier, on the 11th of December, the USS Corps had arrived at Saigon's river port. Aboard were 82 H-21C helicopters and 438 men of the 57th and 8th Transportation Companies, the first helicopter units to arrive in Vietnam. Their mission was to train and transport Arvn soldiers in aerial assaults. Sadly, their first mission would be the recovery of SP4 Davis's body. Their second mission, Operation Chopper, would exact some revenge. The next day, they waited at Tansinut Airport while another DF team got a fix on the VC transmitter Davis had been tracking the previous day. Once they had the location, some 1,000 Arvn paratroopers were airlifted to the site. Upon landing, they came under fire, losing one of their aircraft. After a brief firefight, they captured a Viet Cong headquarters complex and found the transmitter. On the 10th of January, 1962, the 3rd RRU headquarters building was named Davis Station in honor of his sacrifice. In April 1962, the 3rd RRU moved to new quarters in a cantonment alongside the runway at Tansinut Airport. The cantonment was christened Davis Station. All along Basin Street were the administrative facilities of the ASA headquarters and some of its subordinate units. Running parallel were two other streets leading to the enlisted men's quarters and the mess facilities. The barracks, or hooches, each housed 8 to 12 men. They were crude, but comfortable by wartime standards. At the northwestern end was the motor pool and, nearby, the water plant. At the opposite end was the enlisted men's club, which was air-conditioned and offered refreshments, food, and entertainment. They had also built a tennis court in the cantonment, though they would use it most often for volleyball. Although there was no swimming pool at Davis Station, they leased the Miami Pool, located off-base nearby. To assist them in their mundane daily chores, Davis Station employed housemaids and mess hall workers. To keep the grass neat and trim, they employed a specialist. At the corner of Basin Street, a memorial was dedicated to Tom Davis. Before the war was over, the memorial would add another 33 names to the list of ASA members who would fall to the enemy in Vietnam. Given a prominent location, it was a site where many of the Crazy Cats and 30,000 other ASA men arriving and leaving Vietnam over the next 11 years would spend at least a few moments of quiet contemplation. Signaling Vietnam's worsening situation and America's growing involvement there, General Paul D. Harkins arrived in Saigon on the 21st of February, 1962. He had come to command the newly created Military Assistance Command Vietnam, or MACV, absorbing the Military Assistance Advisory Group Vietnam, MAGV, established in Vietnam in July 1950 to assist the French in their war against communist-led Viet Minh. A major technical reorganization followed, with South Vietnam operationally divided into 4 core tactical zones, or CTZs, and a capital military district. A field headquarters controlled each CTZ, or core, while a special command ran the more sensitive capital military district. Meanwhile, ASA and ECOM engineers at Fort Monmouth had developed their first airborne radio direction finding system. Besides giving added security of distance from the enemy, RDIF also raised the receiving antennas into the path of the enemy's high-angle radio waves. The airborne system also eliminated terrain and vegetation barriers as well as giving interceptors much greater mobility. The first RDIF systems were installed in three U-6A de Havilland Beaver aircraft. The Beaver was chosen because they were numerous in Vietnam and maintenance support was readily available. It also offered the pilot good visibility and could carry a crew of three plus a small load of equipment. The 3rd RRU had acquired three of the planes and two pilots from MAG-V, and in March 1962, an ASA ECOM team arrived in Vietnam to install the RDIF equipment, consisting of wing-mounted dipole antennas, radio receivers, and a compass. Like nearly all aircraft that ASA would operate in Vietnam, the U-6As were then given the prefix R, designating it as a reconnaissance aircraft. The RU-6As were assigned to the 3rd RRU's newly established aviation section, which the men soon nicknamed TWA, for Teeny Weeny Airlines. The aircraft were quickly pressed into service, flying operational missions in the 3-Corps sector, and within a month had located the transmitters of 6 major VC headquarters. Thanks to their success, RDIF and COMINT became a top priority in Army aviation. January 1963 saw the arrival of two JU-8D Seminole aircraft, the J prefix indicating a test prototype. Besides having all-weather capability, it had higher speed and longer range than the RU-6A. It also had an improved RDIF system, including a Marconi Doppler navigation system, which provided the constant and precise location needed over dense jungle and mountainous terrain. It also included a bombsight device that allowed the operator to direct the pilots over a known location. The JU-8D was also equipped with blade antennas in the wings, which gave it the capability to home in on a transmitter while flying a standard flight pattern, resulting in a more accurate fix of the enemy's transmitters. Due mainly to RDIF's contribution to the counterinsurgency effort, in May 1963, the 3rd RRU was awarded a Meritorious Unit Commendation, becoming the first unit to be so decorated in Vietnam. With the deployment of U.S. combat forces in early 1965, the need for electronic intelligence grew with the increasing troop levels. To meet that need, ASA progressively developed a variety of systems which were installed on a variety of aircraft. The first to arrive were 7 RU-8Ds, codenamed Seven Roses. This was soon followed by Checkmate, a package of 7 more RU-6As and 10 more RU-8Ds. As U.S. troops entered the ground phase of the war, ASA had 30 RDIF aircraft on hand to support them. These aircraft, like those to follow over the years, were deployed to the 3rd RRU's aviation detachments based in each of the 4 corps: Da Nang in 1 corps, Nha Trang in 2 corps, Tan Son Nhut in 3 corps, and Can Tho in 4 corps. In August 1965, Marines launched the first large-scale American combat operation based upon intelligence of the 3rd RRU. Operation Starlight trapped the 1st VC Regiment on the peninsula near Chu Lai, and with RDIF providing continuous fixes on enemy transmitters, the Marines were able to react to enemy locations and movements. As a result, the Marines claimed an early victory over the enemy, who suffered a loss of more than 600 men. The success of RDIF in tactical support led to the procurement of an additional 11 RU-6As and 34 RU-8Ds of various electronic configurations, codenamed Wine Bottle and Seafish Person. Because the RU-8D could operate in mountainous regions, obtain greater altitudes, and offer increased speeds, it quickly became the RDIF workhorse of the Vietnam War, making a significant contribution in the intelligence provided to theater tactical commanders. In January 1966, a one-of-a-kind RDIF system, codenamed Pathfinder, was installed in a RCV-2B Caribou. It was also the first to be equipped for comint operations, capable of collecting voice and Morse communications for decoding, translation, and analysis. Its operation in Vietnam, however, was short-lived. A heated debate between the Army and Air Force over who should be responsible for tactical airlift came to a climax on the 6th of April that year, with the Army relinquishing the Caribou to the Air Force. In return, the Army would control nearly all helicopter operations except for rescue and special operations. The changeover was complete by the 1st of January 1967. Beginning in March 1967, three RU-1A Otter aircraft began arriving in Vietnam. Codenamed Laughing Otter and Cafe Girl, they were equipped for both RDIF and COMINT operations. On the 30th of June 1967, the Crazy Cats and their five RP-2E Neptunes arrived in Vietnam for a very special mission. Unlike other ASA aircraft in Vietnam, they were not equipped for RDIF. Their mission was to conduct COMINT operations, with three of their five also equipped for electronic warfare capable of jamming enemy radio signals. In December 1968, the first of 18 RU-21D Ute aircraft, codenamed Laughing Eagle, was introduced. Driven by twin turboprop engines, these aircraft carried improved mission gear to include an automated direction-finding capability as a result of the use of an onboard inertial navigation system. They performed both RDIF and COMINT missions. In December 1970, three JU-21A, codenamed Left Jab, arrived. They were the last and most sophisticated RDIF COMINT aircraft used in Vietnam. Left Jab was the first airborne system to give 360-degree DF coverage. It was also the first system to use a digital computer which stored DF calibration tables and took aircraft positions from an inertial navigation system to compute fixes. The ASA also used helicopters in Vietnam. In August 1967, five EH-1D Huey helicopters were equipped with the Left Bank RDIF COMINT system. Three of them were assigned in support of the 1st Cavalry Division, while the other two supported the 4th Infantry Division. At its peak, ASA had an inventory of more than 100 mission aircraft during the Vietnam War. The ASA was joined on Vietnam's electronic battlefield by the U.S. Air Force Security Service, or the AFSS. After early setbacks in the field of RDIF and sensing an embarrassing defeat by the ASA, the U.S. Air Force began a crash program codenamed Phyllis Ann to deploy 35 RDIF-equipped EC-40